So that's it's a bit of a risk.
But. Can you just explain for anybody who's kind of coming new to the sport, and there's still loads of people who are trying to get to grips with what the difference, why is it easier for a tight head to move to loose head than a loose head to move to tight head?
Yeah, okay, so it's a biomechanical advantage, okay, so it's just, it's a physics answer to that question. So a loose head, when a scrum engages, the loose head generally comes in underneath the tight head. There's nothing on his left-hand side. He just has to deal with one player slightly to his right-hand side, but he's underneath his chest. When you're underneath anybody, you've got a biomechanical advantage. So if I was pushing against you and I get down lower than you, I've got the advantage, even if you're a bigger person. So that in itself means it's less technical. A tight head prop has to deal with the guy underneath him, plus the hookers underneath him as well. So you've got two guys coming in underneath you. So you nearly have to be able to slip your shoulder underneath the hooker while bound to your own hooker, and at the same time shorten or minimize the surface area that the loose head has to work with on this side, while maintaining pressure down, while maintaining pressure forward, while maintaining pressure inwards or outwards. Like, you don't scrummage in a dead straight line. You're using subtle angles all the time, and that's all hip maneuverability. But
the loose head has to worry about the bind and the hit, not this.
That's it. And staying tight to his hooker. So if a loose head, the worry for loose head, the difficulty for loose head is, if the tight head can split him, in other words, if he can separate him from the hooker, loose heads tend to turn in to try to get underneath. And when you turn in, your bum comes out. When your bum comes out, you lose your second row. If you lose your second row, you're finished. That's your power. That's where your strength is coming from. So the key to the loose head is to use the outside leg to keep the hip in against the hooker. That's your most important thing. And then make sure you get a good purchase on the tight underneath. And that's to do with the speed you can get underneath. There's a little bit of grappling in the initial stages when you know to have that kind of bind, and then that's set. There's a set. It's less so than when the guys used to engage from a distance, but the engagement and the grappling happens very, very quickly, and the speed at which you can do that can determine whether you get a good position or not. Obviously, the weight at which you come on behind and the pressure you can apply as well. So I'll talk a little bit about that maybe if you want, in terms of how they will be training for that as well.
Yeah, totally. Because like, how do you get better at that kind of stuff? And
so they've got a block of training time now. Okay, I think you guys might have touched about this over the last week or two, regard to how they're preparing and stuff like this. I mean, in sports terms, it's very, very short, okay, to make changes. In other words, in the period of time they have to start a training camp to the World Cup, should really be focused on rugby. I'm going to go back to what we're talking about in a sec, because you can't turn a chihuahua into a Great Dane in that period of time. Yet I hear these things coming out of camp about these guys are doing fantastic and they're going to be way better. You can't do it in that period of time. You've just got to optimize. But to optimize, you have to adapt. So the key is the period of time when you're training, when you start your training camp, is you start your adaptation towards that point. So you start working towards the specifics you need with the key to optimize. So optimization is the end goal at the World Cup. So you have to be very specific to each position. So props, for example, work off principles. It's changed since the engagements and stuff like that, but it works off the principles of certain types of strength, okay? So there's about seven different types of actual strength, like you might have heard of speed strength, explosive strength, static strength, isometric strength, absolute strength. And these things are variables in how your nervous system and your musculoskeletal system operate in terms of executing a task on the pitch, okay? So with a scrum, historically, we used to engage from a distance. So the key strength there is explosive strength and speed across the gap, okay? Establish that, get it very quick, and then maintain the pressure on. That'd be more like isometric strength. So what I mean by isometric means it simply translates to the same length. So when you're doing an exercise, say for example, concentric is shortening the muscle, eccentric is lengthening the muscle, and isometric is same length. So if you get against the wall and push against the wall as hard as you can, but you're not moving the wall, your muscles are still working, that's isometric. So when props engage now, they're engaged before they push, and they have to maintain the pressure. So that's just that they're not going forward, they're not going back. That's isometric. So they need to be very solid in that position. So they need to develop that type of strength. So they establish a very solid platform when they're in that position. And then the next type of strength they need is starting strength. So starting from a position. So if I put you sitting down, and this starting strength means you take what's called a stretch reflex out of the equation. So a stretch reflex is when, you know what a squat is? So squat is when you put a weight in your back, you kind of sit down into a position, you stand up. So when you sit down into that position, the muscles react when you do the turnaround. When you hit the bottom and come back up, there's a mechanism called a stretch reflex, which gives you a bit of momentum to come back up. So if you were jumping, you'd get more height if you went down real quick and came up than if you sat down in a sitting position and tried to accelerate into a jump. Do you get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Do you understand that? So with starting strength, it's the equivalent of starting from that position down in the crouch position. So if I sit you down and I put a weight on your back, you've got to accelerate as quick as possible as you can up without any backward motion and forward motion. And that's what happens in a scrum now, is they engage, they're isometrically engaged, and then you've got to bang it as quick as you can, as soon as that pressure comes on. And that's the key to starting strength. So they're going to develop all this stuff and try to do as much as they can within that period of time. With the same time though, the complexity in rugby is when is in that you've got so many factors to think about, okay? So you've got, you know, that's one aspect of the core component of the physical side of it. But you have to be able to repeat those efforts over 80 minutes, technically speaking, as well. If you have to prepare for that in case there's no substitution. So with that in mind, you have to prepare for a certain amount of speed, strength, endurance as well. You can't just do that once in a game. You have to be able to repeat it over and over again. So if I got a heavyweight powerlifter and I put him in a scrum, he'll destroy a guy for the first scrum, but he won't be able to repeat those efforts over time. So you need to train for that too. So, and then you've got obviously stuff like your skill stuff, your organisation stuff, your understanding of the game, your understanding of the role in the game. And that's where the real complexity comes in. And you're doing this in a short period of time, so you can appreciate quite difficult it is to kind of, you know, get this very perfect coming into the World Cup.
It's very interesting. So we're naturally obviously seeing a difference in how front row players tend to kind of play the ball. They're more ball players these days or whatever it may be, but clearly there's going to be a body shape change to what you're talking about there. Very subtle. It's not something that Joe or I would be able to spot, but probably something you've noticed over the last couple of years.
Yeah, well, you sharpen it. You can change it. Like, body shape takes a lot of time, so you can do that over a period of years, but you can sharpen your ability to execute in those areas over this period of time, definitely, yeah. And you need to step back to go forward. In other words, you need to give the body a little bit of a rest and then really attack it, like, and ramp it up. I mean, so it's not a linear line. It's up a little bit, down a little bit, but overall, you're moving forward that way. But it's very slow. But the important thing, I suppose, as well, is I think the most important thing in terms of bringing a team into a World Cup, apart from obviously the rugby aspects of the plan and the plan A, plan B, and how you fit into that, is having confidence going into the World Cup and having a fresh mind, okay? So if you're in any way fatigued going in, I mean, the 2007 thing is battered around a lot. I think that's a bit more complicated than it was first said, like, and what happened. I think there was other factors involved in that as well. But I just think being very confident and being very fresh is a very is probably as important as having all the physical stuff and even technical stuff right.
Can I ask you about the grappling?
The
grappling. There's a little bit of grappling that happens, and it's really quick, and then it's over because there's obviously no room. What is that, and how do you get better at that?
Okay, so hand position in the scrum is very relevant to advantageous leverage within the scrum. So, for example, what a tight head prop I mentioned needs to reduce the surface area of what the loose head has to work with here, but he also needs to maintain pressure downwards, okay? Now, it depends on the style of play you have, but the pressure downwards involves closing the shoulder off. So the right shoulder of the tight head prop is going to be engaged with the loose head prop like this, and you have to bring, where you're going, your objective is to bring that shoulder, close it. That's closing it, that's opening it. As soon as you open up the shoulder, you are in a very, very precarious position, because not only that, when you lift the shoulder, the hips are connected as well. So if you open the shoulder, the hips move, and that's your power. And as soon as they open up, you are vulnerable to a drive, okay? The key to a loose head driving a tight head back, and I'm gonna emphasize this, a tight head is doing his job if he's holding the scrum. A loose head is not doing his job unless he puts the tight head under pressure. That's the difference. So I said one is easier than the other. Technically it is, but the actual job, if you add it all up, the loose head's expected to put the tight end under pressure because he has the advantage. You're trying to take him out of the game, destabilize the scrum. He can't do it unless he opens up the tight head. So if a tight head can keep the pressure down, and that one of the key principles is closing the shoulder. So even if the arm is up, a good tight head will turn his shoulder like that. He's not going to let this go open like this. So just because you're seeing the arm up doesn't necessarily mean it's open. But if the arm and the shoulder go up, the hip goes up, you're in trouble. So a loose head never gets in under a tight head and just pushes. He lifts first, destabilizes, and then pushes. But once that, this is where the arm grip comes in. So if a loose head can get a very deep grip up on the back, so say for example I'm facing a guy and I have a grip just here, I'm not going to open up anything there because I don't have the leverage. You're trying to open up the elbow to open up this arm. So, but if I'm reaching up and my hand is in the middle of his back and I can open up my elbow, I'm lifting his elbow on top of it. With that, the shoulder goes up and then suddenly he's open. And that's where the grip battle is going on. Also,
how do you practice that though?
you practice, you have to do live situations for that. You have to do one-on-one, three-on-three, two-on-two, and then full scrums. The problem with full scrums is ego gets in the way and guys just don't want to, you know, even in practice, they don't want to.
And injuries happen, yeah.
Yeah, it's unusual to get a serious injury because I think guys are used to these things, but the problem is the quality of the training can diminish when you're trying to perform a task and somebody is at all costs just trying to not go backwards, for example, and then when there's no specific referee in a non where you can't get penalised because this is a training situation, you're not playing a match, guys will cheat as well because they don't want to go backwards. And it's an inherent built-in thing to props. I mean, you don't want to go backwards. And that can sometimes mess things up. If you have a very organised, structured scrum session where there's a concession that, you know, we're just going to practice this, then you can practice the speed at which you bind, the speed at which you get under the opposition player and stuff. So the other thing then, the other grappling part is the height, okay? So that's getting under is the key, or establishing pressure downwards from a point of view. Sorry,
it sounds like a martial art. Are there martial arts that you can practice in your kind of off season that make you better?
Yeah, jiu-jitsu is probably the best one for that. Technical leverages and stuff like that. Yeah, definitely. I mean, the thing about jiu-jitsu, it's a kind of a fairly. I mean, you're from MMA, you probably know a bit about that, would you? They focus on leverage more so than absolute strength, if you like. But grips are hugely important because anything that involves wrestling or grappling, if you like, starts with grips. It always starts with grips. You can't do anything if you don't actually grab the person. Where you grab them is relevant. So for example, in jiu-jitsu, if you grab, or judo even for that matter, if you grab a lapel, like a part of the apparel that they wear, you can push and pull. If you just grab the arm, you can only pull. Like, I mean, thinking like this is relevant, you know. So if you grab the arm of an opponent, he can be much more relaxed. If you grab a fixed part of his body and able to move it, you can push and pull as well. So understanding those concepts is where the martial arts comes into it, and then practicing the speed of the bind, and then grip endurance. So grip strength is one thing, but being able to repeat the effort and not get the forearms tired out so you can actually make that effort is relevant as well, yeah.
That makes sense.